Today we'll be studying the synchronization constructs that we will be actually using. So we have two lectures of synchronization so far. In the first lecture, we introduced and explained the critical section problem. And in the second lecture, we looked into solutions to this critical section problem. And we looked into two kinds of solutions. One is Peterson's solution, which is a theoretical solution or a conceptual solution. The other kind of solutions that we looked at last lecture was hardware-based solutions, hardware instructions. And hardware instructions that are atomic instructions. Now we noticed, or some of you may have noticed last time, that using the hardware instructions directly may not be very convenient. Okay, just like programming in machine code or in assembly. And that's why operating systems provide programmers with high-level constructs.
Bless you. Thanks.
High-level constructs that they can use for synchronization. So these high-level constructs are locks, semaphores, and monitors. Well, the ones that we will be studying. So in fact, today we will be looking into locks and semaphores. And in a later lecture, we will be looking into monitors. So today's lecture is going to be about locks and semaphores. So these are synchronization constructs that are provided by the operating system, and they are built on top of the hardware instructions. So the operating system uses hardware support to provide programmers with these easy-to-use synchronization constructs. We will see that using the lock, for example, will easily solve the critical section problem. So they are very easy to use. There are abstractions that are built on top of the hardware support. Okay. So that's what we will be studying today. So let's first look into locks. So what's a lock? A lock is an operating system construct that allows a process to lock the critical section. What does locking the critical section mean? Locking the critical section means that while this process is in the critical section, no other process is allowed to be in the critical section. And everything is managed by the operating system. So if we have a lock X, if process number one does If process number one does lock X, and it does its critical section, then it does unlock X. Lock is sometimes called acquire. So here, they're using acquire. In the POSIX library, in the POSIX standard, which is what we will be using in our assignment, they're called lock and unlock. So there is lock and unlock. But you can you can call them acquire and release, for example, because it's the same concept. So if a process does this lock X, critical section, unlock X, and process 2, for example, does lock X, critical section, unlock X, and process 3 does lock Y, critical section, unlock Y, then if process number 1 executes this lock, which is implemented as a system call, so it would be an API. If you use POSIX, it's an API, but it's implemented as a system call. The actual implementation on the line implementation is a system call. The system is locking X for this process. So now process number one can proceed and use the critical section and modify the shared variable. Now, if process number two arrives, it will not be allowed to enter the critical section because the critical section is locked by process number one. Right. And all of this is managed by the operating system. You are guaranteed that the lock operation is atomic, and you are guaranteed that process will not get interrupted in the middle of locking, and you are guaranteed that when a process has the lock and it's in the critical section, you are guaranteed that no other process will be allowed to access the critical section when this process is in the critical section. Now, if a process, process three, for example, is trying to access a critical section that is locked by lock Y, then this has nothing to do with X. If process number one is in lock X, this is a totally different lock. So process number three can access this critical section. That's a different critical section that is protected by a different lock. Also, it's important to understand here that if a process in the critical section, the operating system is not guaranteeing you that this process will not get interrupted by the timed interrupt, for example. There is no guarantee that this process will keep the CPU while it's in the critical section. The guarantee is that another process is attempting to access the critical section will be blocked. But this process that is in the critical section may lose the CPU multiple times while it's in the critical section. But even if it loses the CPU or whatever happens, any other process that is trying to access a critical section that is protected by the same lock, lock X, will not be allowed to access the critical section. Okay? And now, how are these locks implemented? Now, it's important to understand that there are two different ways of implementing these locks. The process that is waiting for the critical section could be in a busy waiting loop. It could be in a busy waiting loop like this. This is a conceptual description of acquire and release, or lock and unlock, where the process is checking on a variable available, and as long as the variable is unavailable, it's going to keep looping. So this is busy waiting. So when a process is doing this, it's wasting CPU cycles, right? Or it's potentially wasting CPU cycles. And eventually, when it gets into the critical section, it's going to set available to false to lock that critical section. And when it's done, it's going to set it to true. Now this is not actual operating system code. This is not how a lock is actually implemented in an operating system. This is a conceptual description. This is conceptual. And in fact, this implies that the lock is implemented as in a busy waiting way. Now, when the lock is implemented using busy waiting, we call it a spin lock. A spin lock implies that it's implemented using busy waiting. Otherwise, it's just a regular mutex lock. Now, if a lock is not implemented using busy waiting, how do you think it would be implemented? How else could a lock be implemented without busy waiting? What do you think the other alternative is?
Put a queue on the lock that can call the second process when in the unlock is?
Yeah, exactly, using a queue. So basically, for each lock, there is a queue. So for lock X, there is a queue. When P1 arrives, the queue is empty, no other process has the lock or waiting for the lock, so it will get into the critical section. Now, when process number two arrives, the clock is taken by process number one, so it would be just placed in a queue. X, and there is a queue for X, and process number 2 will be placed in this queue. Now, when process number 2 is in this queue, what's the state of process 2? What's the state? What could it be? Wait. So this is waiting. So this is another kind of waiting. So far we have seen, you know, different kinds of waiting or different reasons for waiting. One of them was waiting for an I/O device. An I/O device has a queue, waiting in the queue for an I/O device. Another is waiting for a parent waiting for a child. So that's another kind of waiting that we have seen. We've seen another kind of waiting, which is what? So there is yet another kind of waiting that we have seen. About waiting for a message, waiting for a message to get received or received or sent. Right? So there were two kinds of message passing, send and receive, right? So there's, what are the two kinds of message passing? There's blocking and non-blocking. So if it's blocking, send or receive, the process that is waiting is in the waiting state for that message. By the way, sometimes, you know, in the context of operating systems, the blocking and waiting may be used interchangeably. So blocking, a process blocks or waits, it means that process is in the waiting state, it's not on the ready queue, and the scheduler cannot select it for the CPU. Okay, so now this is spin lock versus interlock. Now this is an important concept. We would like to understand the advantages and disadvantages of each, or in other words, when to use a spin lock and when to use a mutex lock. When does it make sense to use a spin lock and when does it make sense to use a mutex lock? So now the first question, is if we expect this, if this critical section is small, so a critical section is normally an update of a shared variable. So if this critical section is just like, you know, updating, incrementing a variable, then this is expected to be, not to take a long time, expected to complete within a short period of time. And the process that is waiting is not expected to be waiting for a long time. In this case, which will make more sense, a spin lock or a mutex lock? Spin lock? Yeah, spin lock. Just like you're waiting for something and you expect it to be done within a short period of time, you know, like your car, you go to get your car fixed and they tell you that it's going to be ready in 10 minutes or 15 minutes. If it's 10 minutes or 15 minutes, you wait for it, right? But if it's going to take hours, then you will leave it and come back later, right? So it's very much the same concept. If we don't expect X to be waiting for a long time, then it makes sense to use a spin lock. But now the question is, does it make sense to use spin locks when you have a single CPU? If you have a single CPU, does it make sense to use a spin lock, and why? Would it be efficient to use a spin lock, and why? So now this is in the critical section. This is updating the shared variable, and this is waiting. But now, you know, the point in doing a spin lock is to avoid a context switch. So if this process is in the running state, if it has the CPU, we hope that it will not be waiting for a long time, and that very quickly, within a few cycles, the lock will become available, and this process will proceed into the critical section without having to lose the CPU, without, you know, switching state, or without context switching. But can this happen when you have a single CPU? Can this ever happen? Can a process that is waiting ever get the critical section without losing the CPU, if there is a single CPU?
No.
No, why not?
Because process one still has to unlock it?
Yeah, so there is a single CPU. And even if this is only, if there are only a few operations here, or a couple of operations, this process needs the CPU in order to make progress. And if the CPU is with this process, the CPU is with P2, and we have a single CPU, then necessarily P1 doesn't have the CPU. And without having the CPU, it will not be able to make any progress. Right? So it doesn't make sense to do spin locking when you have a single CPU. Because the cycles, the CPU cycles that this process is using here to wait, it will have taken CPU cycles from the process that is supposed to be making progress and complete executing its critical section in order to get to unlocking. Yeah.
Why would P2 ever even get the CPU if it's waiting?
What's that?
Would P2 ever even get the CPU? Because it wouldn't be in the waiting state if it's waiting for the lock?
Well, so if it's in the waiting state, if it would be in the waiting state, then when P1 is done with the critical section, it would be doing unlocking. Now, what does unlocking mean? How does the system implement an unlock when there is a queue? It's going to look at the queue and see if there is a process that has been waiting for that semaphore. If there are multiple processes, then it's going to pick one of them, and it will change the state of that process from waiting to ready. So unlocking means if a process has been waiting for this lock, then change its state from waiting to ready. Okay, yeah.
If there are multiple items in the queue for a lock, will it push them all to ready, or will, because it can't know if they're going to relock it, right?
So what does make sense here? To push all of them to ready or only one of them? So what are we trying to accomplish here with locks?
That only one process has access to a critical section at a time?
Yeah. So what we are trying to accomplish is only one process in the critical section. So for locks, it makes sense to, if there are multiple processes waiting, pick one of them and put it in the ready state.
So what happens when a process has access to a lock and it's terminated? Does that unlock and grant access to the waiting process?
Yeah, this process terminates.
Right, to some exception, or? Or is that just not something that happens while in the critical section?
Yeah, it can happen. Well, if you wrote this code and then you forgot to unlock and the process exits without unlocking, then that may cause a bug. That will cause the lock to be held forever. All right, so that's a bug. You know, if in your code you lock without unlocking, or, you know, here there is an if statement somewhere here that says if this condition is true, exit, and you exit without unlocking, then that's a bug. You should do if condition unlock and then exit. Okay, so it's the programmer's responsibility to make sure that they unlock before they exit. That's for normal termination. Now, if there is an exception, well, that means that the process did something wrong anyway, and that process will get terminated. Spin locking makes sense if you are going to wait for a short period of time on a multiprocessor system. On a multiprocessor system, spin locking makes lots of sense if the waiting time is going to be short, because, you know, you can have P1 on CPU 0 and P2 on CPU 1. Each one is on a different CPU. So this is making progress on the critical section, and this is spinning. And if the critical section is small, spinning will happen only for a short period of time. So we will be wasting a few machine cycles. But then process number 2 may get the lock without losing the CPU, without ever getting interrupted. Okay, so this is the concept of mutex lock versus spin lock.